Hello to everybody. Welcome back to this channel. To all of you who are connected to us through the different channels of the mass media, through YouTube especially, and through those other social nets in Instagram, in Facebook. So welcome. And if you are new to this channel, so we welcome you. We are Mike and Drew Vlogs, and so we are here to try to collaborate in the different areas of our life which we need somehow to grow. Today I have a topic interesting. It can be for somebody, for some people, for some no. So according to you, let me know if it's interesting for you. If you have any questions at the end of this presentation, you may ask also through the chats here down. You may know me also personally. You may ask me also things like by WhatsApp, by Messenger, or even through the comments on Facebook, if it ever happens that this video goes on Facebook. So we are Mike and Drew Vlogs, so welcome. And if you are not yet subscribed, please subscribe here down so that you may be always aware of when we upload new videos, and also that we may go ahead also with this project with your help. With your help means with subscribing, with commenting, with giving us a like, with your sharing on the different channels of communication which nowadays we have in society. So your subscription and your like and your share and your comments helps us a lot to go ahead. So here we are today. I want to offer you a challenging and interesting for many of us. For me also it's interesting, this topic of which I am going to talk today to you. I am going to talk to you about atheism. Atheism that either in the practical way or in the formal way. Later I will explain you what I mean by practical and by formal way of being an atheist. The atheism is present in our society since all the times, since humanity came up, and since humanity, it is a society of people living together, so everyone can have the opportunity to share his beliefs and even not to share it, to refuse to believe or not to believe in any deity and in any God, in any spiritual being. So it has been present in the history of humanity always. Actually, by refusing not to adore the gods of the society in the antiquity, for the state was a very challenging situation, because the atheists not only divided the society, it divided also how to call the person with the government. Because refusing to follow the customs of the society. For the church, it has been always an endeavor, but a plague which it is necessary in a good way to try to convince them to believe, because not only divides the members of the church in itself, but also puts in danger the life of the soul, the spiritual life, the soul's salvation, and the salvation of the souls of others also. So it has been always a challenging, and the church has needed to come every now and then and always to new ways to try to come into agreement, to try to convince the atheists, because it this helps to have the society united, to have the church united, and to help also to others to get to a better life, because it's proved that the life of the people with God, it is better than the life of a person who has not God in his heart. So from here also I can argue something already. Saints, for example, have come with that great interest. For example, San Anselm came up with the ontological argument, trying to convince the infidels to believe in God. He came with this ontological argument. Saint Thomas came up also later with the five ways of proving God's existence. By the way, Saint Thomas doesn't agree with Saint Anselm, because he said that Saint Anselm has argued before that God's existence is so self-evident that we should believe, and if we don't believe, we are like the fools of which the Psalm talks about. Because if you consider the word God, if you consider it already, then you admit there is something. And Saint Anselm say this: God is the a thing which nothing greater can be thought about. Saint Thomas says it is not possible to show and to prove the God's existence just by considering that God is that which nothing greater can be thought about. Why? Because it presupposes that we know God's essence. And to know God's essence is impossible. It's impossible for us, because we have a limited capacity to know God. Saint Thomas, in his intense zeal for the salvation of souls, which at the same time also we know he had expressed in his prayers, in his life, in his whole works for the salvation of the infidels, for the salvation of the souls. He often in his prayers used to say, "Lord God, what will happen with the poor sinners if you don't come to them in your mercy?" So this intense zeal for the salvation of souls drove Saint Thomas to come up with the different five ways of showing God's existence. As a teacher, he always considered a great privilege to know the truth. But he would consider even a greater privilege to make known that truth. And this is the reason he preferred the life of a preacher, for example, because he felt that life of teaching, in that life of teaching, he could envelop, he could even unfold all other aspects of his life. For he argued that from what is naturally more known to us, we could reach to higher things and to prove even God's existence. So he came up with the five ways. In this presentation, so I want to tell you that I want to focus in more before maybe in these three of five ways. There are five ways of Saint Thomas, but I want to focus more in three. So we are going to see God's existence as self-evident to us. We are going to see how Saint Thomas, thinks that this is possible to prove God's existence. That this proposition, God exists, is demonstrable. So, and therefore, that God in reality does exist. I find useful for this presentation also to this talk I am going to do to you today, to make, in a way of a second introduction, an overview of at least three aspects of the life of Saint Thomas, the personality of Saint Thomas. And for this purpose, I want to say in few words what Etienne Gilson, in his book Thomism, says about this, because certainly Saint Thomas, in these three aspects of his life, goes beyond of a talk that I am giving you today. These three aspects, according to Gilson, are his holiness, his theological aspect, and his mystical interior life. Here we are more interested to his philosophical reflections, which he puts into the service of theology. There is in Thomas this aspect of teacher. which envelops all other aspects of his personality. Because he is, first of all, a teacher of theology and of philosophy, St. Thomas considers that if to know the truth, as I have said already, it is a great thing, it was even greater to make it known to others. This he said already in the Summa Contra Gentiles. And that is why between the contemplative life of the monks and the life of the preachers, he chooses the active life because it more fittingly represented the life of Christ. However, as Gilson says, he knew how to integrate his meditations into his preaching life. And this we can see it in the impetuous endeavor for the salvation of souls, where philosophy, as the servant of theology, is put at the service of the teaching of theology in order to make known the truth of salvation to everybody. St. Thomas starts from the argument that if God wills our salvation, it is necessary that he give us some tools so that we may reach at least a certain knowledge, at least a partial knowledge of the truths of salvation. Therefore, by our speculative, philosophical, even natural knowledge, we can reach to certain basic knowledge of some attributes of God, or at least we can prove that God exists. So, nevertheless, there remain mysteries of God which only faith can enlighten to become the sure port to which I address myself, to which I address all my endeavors. This port, as I like to call it, because it's a point to arrive, it is not yet visible for us, and only faith can assure of its mysteries. Philosophy can demonstrate that God exists without violating the nature of theology, which also doesn't not violate the nature of the human being itself, but enlightens it to consent, to accept, to go into the higher truths. So with this general presentation, I want to go directly on the topic of atheism. Atheism in general is characterized by the absence of the belief in the existence of God. As the word itself indicates, it comes from the Greek word atheos, and it can be referred to, in a wider sense, to the absolute opposition, to the absolute opposition to believe in the existence of any spiritual being. To us, especially, we are saying atheism refers to the opposition to believe in God, the only God, the one God. But in general, it's the opposition to believe in the presence of and the existence of any spiritual being. According to Drachman in his book entitled Atheism in Atheism in Pagan Antiquity, the word atheos has exactly the same meaning as the word ungodly, and is the oldest usage. He says that we can that it can be traced in history as we have it. In this sense, in the antiquity, the word atheos was used to refer to those who refused to worship the gods of the state, to the gods of the society. We have examples of that, for example, with the ancient philosophers, in which, as Plato, for example, give us beautiful recordings of what was going on in the antiquity. During the Christian era, nevertheless, this term atheism is said that emerged for first time, the term itself as atheism, in the 16th century, already in persons. During the 18th century was already a time where the people was already so courageous to say, I am atheist, close already there to the Enlightenment that make a lot of changes. In the life of a lot of people worldwide, it had these consequences. Thus, we could see that atheism is antecedent and also even as a product or even inserted in the same life of the time of the Enlightenment during the French Revolution. People like Baron de Holbach also talk of implicit atheism to refer to whoever doesn't have yet any belief of any deity. Interestingly, he puts here, for example, the babies who are newborn, who have not yet the use of reason, those who have mental sickness, those who have severe mental or brain damages, those who have absolutely not knowledge of any spiritual being. He put them there here as an implicit atheism. While he puts as explicit atheists those who willingly, those who reasonably, consciously reject to believe in the existence of God. There are others also who put in more or less these categories different people. For example, some they say about positive atheism, in this case is the English philosopher Anthony Gerard. The American philosopher also Michael Martin. They talk about this positive atheism to refer to the explicit or formal denial of God's existence, and they put in the other side the negative atheists, those who we talk already, those who have not any knowledge of theistic beliefs of spiritual beings. So they are categorized between positive atheism and negative atheism. There are more different kinds of people who is atheist. Also, for example, we have those who hold that we cannot know God, or even we cannot prove God's existence. And they are, for example, the agnostic. The agnostic, not the gnostic, but the agnostic atheists. There is also, for example, the rationalist agnosticism that we talked a little bit already during the French Revolution, and specifically as a product of the Enlightenment. People like Kant, who say that only those things that are deduced by human reason it is possible to exist. Therefore, God, we cannot understand him, God cannot exist. We can think also of a kind of atheism, also in the form of skepticism. These people who are not sure if they really know. For example, like Hume, David Hume, with whom there is this impossibility of the certainty of everything that we see. Therefore, the existence of God is uncertain. Arguments, for example, against God's existence, like the problem of evil, is another challenge also, have been very common always, since there is a difficulty in reconciling this seeming contrast between God's essential attribute, that God is good, that God is all-powerful, and all these things, with the existence of evil in the world, that actually we can touch it, we can feel it, we experience it in everyday life. So how is possible that God is all-powerful, but there exists the evil? How is possible that God is good, but the evil also exists? Other challenges, for example, faith has encountered in the last centuries, has been the psychoanalytic understanding of faith, for example, in which faith is seen as an invention, a human invention, as Sigmund Freud will think, or even Feuerbach, who gave rise to the idea in Marx, because Marx studied Feuerbach, and from him he took the idea that the faith is an excuse to repress the working classes. He believed, Marx believed that way, even thought it in that way. So the point here is, how do we respond to all these kinds of atheism? The five ways that St. Thomas Aquinas give us, do you think that it helps us to get to any point of this, to get any answer for them? We have also a kind of answer to atheism. by denying it. It is interesting because people say no, atheism doesn't exist. So and this is the theistic inatheism. The theistic inatheism is the people who thinks that everybody was born already with an innate belief in God, and therefore there is not such a thing as atheism. They don't exist. It's a denial. They don't exist. Don't worry. Don't worry. They don't exist. Nevertheless, we know that even it's true that we were born with an innate desire, with an innate desire to know God. That therefore we have a little knowledge of God already in ourselves, since we tend to know God. Even if it's true that we know that atheism actually do exist in the present, because we feel it, we touch it, we meet people who don't believe in God, and we as baptized people, we need to give an answer to all these difficulties, to all these inquiries of these people. For this purpose, going directly to the five ways of Saint Thomas, we have we have at our disposition three articles of the question number 2 of the prima parts of the Summa Theologiae of Saint Thomas Aquinas. So, Summa Theologiae, prima parts, question 2, articles from 1 to 3 are talking about this. So, in the first article, for example, I want to resume it to you. Saint Thomas explains how and why God's existence is not self-evident to us, because there were those who were saying, no, God's existence is self-evident to us, so you don't need to worry, you don't need to prove it. To those who argue that the existence of God, for example, is self-evident, because Damascene has said in the beginning that the knowledge of God is naturally implanted in us all, Saint Thomas answers that the fact that man naturally desires the beatific vision, and thus we can say that he knows God in a general, or even say in a confused way, this doesn't mean that this is equal to know absolutely that God exists. Just as to know that someone is approaching, it is not the same as to say Peter it is approaching. So it is different. The second objection is that it's important actually, because it contains the ontological argument of Saint Anselm, and it is more known and used by many to show that the existence of God is self-evident. Saint Thomas finds difficulties, as I said already, with this, because not everyone who hears the word God understands it to signify something that which nothing greater can be thought about. But let's say, even if he's taking for granted that a person understands that it is something about which nothing greater can be thought about, this doesn't follow for that that we understand that what the word signifies, it really exists actually, but only that it exists mentally. Can be, somebody can say that, exists only in your mind, in your ideas. Even more, it cannot be argued that it actually exists, unless it be admitted that there is actually, that really actually exists as something that which nothing greater can be thought about. And this is precisely what the atheism refuses to believe in that. It doesn't admit that it really exists. So, it is impossible. For the third objection, which argues, is the one who argues from the necessary existence of truth. Since God is truth itself, as he has said already, I am the way, the life, the truth and the life, then it comes to be that God's existence in this way is self-evident to us. But Saint Thomas answers that the existence of truth in general is self-evident, but the existence of primal truth is not so self-evident to us. Therefore, nobody can hold that, for example, we say that if we assume that God exists, that God's existence is so self-evident to us, that it is not necessary to prove his existence. We need to understand nobody can hold the contrary of what is self-evident. I have this pen here. I cannot hold the contrary. This pen doesn't exist because it is here. Nobody can hold the contrary of what is self-evident. But we read in Holy Scriptures, for example, that the fool said in his heart, in the Psalms, it says this, there is no God. Therefore, it cannot be that God's existence is so self-evident. For somebody has been no self-evident, for the fool, at least. To conclude this point, let us see that St. Thomas puts it easy in the Respondeo. This is this part where he answers generally, saying that a thing can be self-evident in two ways. One way is being self-evident in itself and to us. And the second way of being self-evident is being self-evident in itself and to us. Now, we reach to the point that God exists and is self-evident in itself, yes. In itself. Due to the fact that in God, his essence and his existence are one thing. So, therefore, if he exists, he is self-evident. But to himself, because he knows himself in one act of knowledge. He knows himself, therefore he exists. But not to us, because we don't know God's essence, because we have a limited capacity of knowledge. Therefore, the existence of God needs to be demonstrated by things that are more known to us, though they are less known in their nature, in their nature. Say, namely, by the arguments for the possibility of demonstrating God's existence. So, these things that we have in front. So, we have this the arguments for the impossibility of demonstrating God's existence, and are one, for example, that it cannot be demonstrated what is an article of faith, because faith, as Hebrews 11:1 has said, is about things that are unseen. There is another point also, that since we have said God's essence and existence are one, and we cannot know God's essence, then we cannot know God's existence. Second, then the third, that even if his existence could be demonstrated by his effects are infinitely disproportionate, and we know that we cannot prove the existence of a cause by a disproportionate effect of this cause. But St. Thomas answers in this way. Remember, St. Thomas goes in this way of questions or objections, and he answers later. He answers to these objections. To the first, he answers that those things which natural reason can understand, including the proposition that God exists, are not articles of faith, but they are the preambles of the articles of faith. What are the preambles? Maybe a little parenthesis. The preambles of the articles of faith are those things which you don't need faith to understand it, to believe it. You just believe it because it's so self-evident. So these things are preambles of the faith. That God exists is a preamble of faith. You don't need faith to believe it. To the second objection, he answers that because in order to prove the existence of anything, we know it is necessary to accept as a middle term the meaning of the word and know its essence. And since the name given to God are derivates from his effects, then in demonstrating the existence of God from his effects, we may take as the middle term the meaning of the word God. To the third, also, we let's pass to the third objection he has received already, and now he answers that we can demonstrate the existence of God from his effects, though from them we cannot know God perfectly as he is in his essence. Furthermore, the apostle in Romans 1:20, I was saying that the apostle Saint Paul in Romans 1:20 has said that the invisible things are clearly seen in the things he has created, or said that God has created. Then it means, this means that the existence of God can be demonstrated by the things he has made in his creation. This means that we can go from the effects of God's existence to know his existence in at least in a partial way, in a blurred way. Everything seen now of God is seen like in a blurred way, in a blurred mirror in which we can see reflected God's existence. I want to pass already to some of the other challenges faith finds nowadays in our society. We said already the problem of evil. To this, we could argue how to call, because the problem of evil, and how say, the problem of evil is again one of the more arguments of atheism in favor of the non-existence of God. If evil exists, as if it's so evident in this the case that we find it every day in the world, in the everyday life of every people, so we cannot deny it. And we experience it, then either God absolutely doesn't exist, or we can deduce that if he's a God, then he's a weak God because he cannot stand evil. Therefore, we need to question. We need to understand how it's possible that if God exists, how it's possible that evil exists in the world still. It could be argued also that whatever we see in nature can be reduced to the principle of nature. People think that, no? In reality, it doesn't exist God if nature brings up new things in nature. Whatever even is reasonable that you can understand is also reduced to the principle of human reason. So it is in your mind, as we said already. All these challenges that the atheism or even, say, formal in the explicit denial of God's existence, of believing in the existence of God, or in the practical way the people who go to church even say that they are Catholic, but in the end they are not Christian, or we are Guadalupani, we are Guadalupanos, pero no somos cristianos. We are followers of Our Lady of Guadalupe, but we don't believe in Christ. So this practical atheism who bring us always these difficulties, all this, no? To this argument, Saint Thomas responds, first of all, that it is part of the infinite of goodness of God that he should allow evil to come up so that he may also produce good, so he may bring also good out of evil. Second, for example, that since everything in nature and reason works for a determinate higher end, then all things that are changeable and capable of defect must be traced back in a unmovable and self-necessary first principle. And this first and unmovable mover, we understand it to be God. Even more, that God exists, we can see it simply and authoritatively. When God speaks in Exodus 3:14, where he says, "I am who I am." Now, Saint Thomas goes on to explain the five ways. I will present you the five ways briefly, and then I will go to the three ways that I find it more easy. As yeah, my preferences. Before making this brief presentation of the five ways in general, let us note that Saint Thomas talks of five ways and not of five proofs. Why did he prefer the use of the word ways instead of proofs? According to Maritain, he held some reasons for this, because the way proofs are proofs. The ways are proofs, are demonstrations, But it can be misunderstood if we say demonstration proves, because to prove or to demonstrate something would be like to seem to attempt to render evident God by our arguments. And although not to us, he is self-evident to himself. In other words, he doesn't need us. He doesn't lack any evidence to prove his existence. To himself, he's self-evident. So what our arguments do, what they do is to render God existence self-evident, but render evident by this testimony that we find in his creation, in the vestiges of what he has created, in the marks that he has left in his creation. Saint Thomas starts with the most famous way, for example, that is the argument from motion, because he says that it is most certain and manifest to our senses that everything that moves is moved by another body. As long as this other body that moved it, this other one, it was in act already. This is the first way. The second way argues from the nature of efficient cause. We experience in our world that everything that has a cause and nothing can cause itself. But the series of causes cannot go into the infinite backwards. Therefore, there should be a first efficient cause that moves everything. This is the second way. The third way argues from the fact that in our world there are things that are possible to be and not to be. Being possible to be as it is possible, it's possible to be because it's possible to be generated. And it's possible also not to be for that being because it's also possible that it may decay, may disappear. But if everything that is possible to be is also possible not to be, then at this moment there could be anything. There could not be anything in the world, and that is absurd because we have it. Therefore, there must be of necessity a being that is not dependent for his being on another being, and that's not possible not to be, because he doesn't depend of for his being on another being. He, this being, self-subsistent, of necessity exists and doesn't depend in anybody else. The fourth way talks and takes into account the different degrees of perfection that we find in things. We find that a thing is more perfect than other in the degree that it resembles in the most perfect way to the cause of its perfection. Therefore, there should be a being which is most perfect, causing the perfection of all other beings, and not accepting a greater degree of perfection in itself, and this most perfect being, we think that it is God. There is the last way, the fifth way, that is dedicated to the final causality of everything that exists. Here is shown how it is deduced that most here is shown how is deduced that a most intelligent being should be at the direction of everything to reach its finality, since the things that like intelligence, for example, we have seen as the celestial bodies, I will say, but Saint Thomas doesn't talk of celestial bodies in this case. It will refer more to the bodies that lack intelligence, but in the sense of that they are pushed to incoming to be by a most excellent being. These beings, for example, that I am talking about, they move always towards an end, which is has been fixed, I say, by an intelligent being. And this intelligent being we know, and I call him God. This is the one who directs everything towards the final end. Finally, I want to come to the three of these five ways that I prefer, that is easier for me to understand them and to express better how God it really exists. Let us go into. And with these five ways, I am going to finish this, okay? Among these five ways, Saint Thomas prefers the first, and this is the first also I am going to present you as my favorite ones. Why? Because, as he says, it is the most certain and most evident to our experiences of everyday life. We see that whatever moves, it moves because it is moved by another body, which is also moved by another. Everything is in potentiality to be moved, and once it has been moved, it reaches its act, and is also in potentiality in this actuality to move another bodies. For motion, Saint Thomas repeats from Aristotle that it is nothing else than the reduction of something from potentiality to the actuality. From here, we realize that if a body is reduced from potentiality to actuality, is only by another body which is in full actuality. For this purpose, Saint Thomas uses the example of fire, which, being actually hot, it is able to reduce the wood from the potentiality of being hot to the actuality of being in actuality hot. As we need to repeat words and words sometimes here because it follows a kind of not syllogistic, as sometimes, yes, but a logic way. So we need to repeat sometimes, sorry. And thus, the wood, once it has reached its full actuality of being actually hot because it is fire, it's therefore transformed into the actuality of fire, and now it is possible for this wood to, we can go on, to reduce the potentiality of the water to be actually hot. And thus, the water, once has reached its full actuality of being hot, it can reduce my potentiality of me being in potentiality to be hot, to be actually hot because it warms my body. And thus we could go ahead. And also we need to go back also in the sense, what made the fire hot? I don't know, maybe my actions of putting wood into the fire, my actions of blowing to make the fire come up. But then I will need to go back into the into who made me to get the breath to blow into the fire, who may gave me the sticks of wood to fire up the fire, sorry. So we need to go back and back for the same water, for example, as we were arguing from the water. The same water which he was before in potentiality to be had, now is actually to be had. But this water cannot be at the same time in potentiality to be had and in actuality to be had. Either it is hot or it is hot. It can be that it's in actuality hot, but it is only in potentiality to be cold because it can degree, lose the degrees of heat, and then to go back to be cold. So it can be that it's in potentiality only to be cold. So nothing can be in actuality and in potentiality at the same time, in the same sense. So the same, a body cannot be at the same time a mover and to be moved, because it would come to be that it moves itself, in that it is not possible. Therefore, it must be that the moved body was moved by another body who was already in actuality, which at its time was moved by another body, and thus go on antecedent bodies. But at some time we need to stop because there will be no explanation in that. Otherwise, they will never find a first mover which moves the other body. If we go on this way, we will be a moment in which nothing will be moving, and this will be contradicting what we experience nowadays, because we see that many bodies are moving. So there should be a first mover that moves everything without being self being moved by another. In himself, he moves himself. He is the cause of himself. He is the one who, without being moved other bodies. So the first and mover, it is God. We call him God. So should exist and a first and mover. Otherwise, we will never find in this vicious cycle who moved this body, and this body who moved the other body, and we'll go back. Nadie will explain it. So we conclude that there should be a first mo unmoved mover, that is God. I jump into the third way because I want to make it in the way possible, reasonable possible, shorter. So this thing we can talk hours and hours and hours, and we could not ever finish, especially because we are talking about God, who is infinite. We could pass whole life talking about God, and it would be impossible to say everything that is just to say. We move so to the third way. That's the third way, the second one that I find easier for me to understand it and to explain it. We need to accept here the preexistence of matter. Here, the existence of God is deduced by the argument of possibility and necessity of being in everything that it exists. More or less, go in the same way as the other ways, arguing from the necessity and possibility of being in everything. We find this way a little particularly challenging. Nevertheless, we take it because after paying close attention to the logic that it follows, it drives to the conclusion that there must be a being which necessarily exists and gives being to all other beings without itself being dependent on other beings. Saint Thomas says that in nature we find things that are possible to be and not to be. I would say that everything, except for example the celestial bodies which cannot be generated, nevertheless, due to their condition of having been created, they are in potentiality to disappear. Of the rest of beings we find in nature, they are all possible to be and not to be. Why? Because as I said already, they can be generated, but they also in potentiality not to be, or should say not to exist, because they are possible to die and to disappear. So they are possible to be and not to be. The difficulty in this is that the things cannot always exist, as we said already and repeated. Because if they are possible not to be, so then at some time they were not in being. So if everything is possible not to be, then at time there could be that there have been nothing ex in existence. That would mean also that we would not have anything as we have it nowadays before us, in front of us, all these things. Because everything that comes to be, that comes into existence, it comes to be by something which previously existed. This is equal to say that if at one time there was nothing into existence, then it was impossible for everything to start to exist. But that is clearly impossible since we have many things in the present. So because of all of this, we need to conclude that everything is not merely possible. That there are some things that necessarily exist, necessarily by themselves. So we can go ahead with these necessary things. There are two different kinds of necessary things. These necessary things, either some of them they receive their being from another necessary being, as it is the case of the celestial bodies, Also, there are those necessary beings which do not receive their being from another necessary being. And this we already deduce that we refer to God. As if is, for example, in the case, the first case, let us suppose the first case, let us suppose that the necessary, if in the first case, for example, we suppose that all beings receive their being from another necessary being, which is also have received its being from another necessary being, then we fall into again to the vicious cycle of going back into the infinite regression, and that is not possible because it displays nothing. Therefore, we need to accept that there is a being which necessarily exists without depending on another being for his existence, and this being we call God. Finally, we have the fifth way. The fifth way takes into account the governance of the world, the providential way in which God directs the world. With God, of course, as the first principle, as the first efficient and final cause of everything that exists, we have this exitus and reditus that we could say, we could mention here. We know that actually everything has an end that is divinely set, to which everything acts, to which everything acts, it's directed to, and from which everything comes and to which everything turns to find its rest. There is here in this way, Saint Thomas puts as an example the natural bodies which lack any kind of intelligence. For example, it seems that this example is the most appropriate to show that there is an intelligent being who is the first efficient cause of everything, at the same time that this first cause is the final cause towards everything tends, because it finds its rest in it is fullness, it is perfection. These unintelligent beings that we call act for an end, which is evident by their movement, which is almost always the same, as to have their best outcome of achieving their final end. Let us think of the moon, of the stars, spinning, always in the same way as to reach an end. But which end? It may be asked to us. An end that which was divinely set by God. An end that is not fortuitously, not by chance, but divinely designed. Therefore, if these bodies which lack intelligence move towards an end, that means that there should be an intelligent being who directs them to their final end, as the arrow is shot but to the mark by an intelligent being who is the archer. Or as the stick, for example, that is used by an intelligent being to do what he wants to do, the intelligent being wants to do. So here also, we should conclude with the conclusion that Saint Thomas comes to, that there must be an intelligent being who directs every movement of every being towards an achievement of the final end. And this intelligent being, we know that is God, because yeah, it is understandable, it is logical, it is self-evident that things cannot move by themselves towards an end which only an intelligent being can understand and set it. So, this can be our ways of answering to an atheism that is so present in our world today. And this can be our answers, helping, finding a help in Saint Thomas' positions. But the problem is that since Saint Thomas has said in another point that I haven't touched because of the time, since the atheist lacks faith and argues from the seeming absurdity of holding that God exists because he has no faith, also because he expects to see God as a old man with a beard outside the window that is calling me here. I can greet him, I can shake his hand. He expects that because he has no faith, because also he cannot see him. So we need to find a way to answer them. The believer needs to be prepared to give an answer, and not from faith alone, but he needs to give an answer from the things that are more visible to us. So an answer that is rooted in the evidences of God's presence, in the realities that he has created, the realities of his creation that are more common, more understandable, more visible, more touchable to all of us, to the atheist, to the atheist person, and to us also. So we reached to the conclusion of this talk a little longer. I could say many other things, but believe me, there is not much time to say. Even if I want to say everything, it will be impossible. So I hope this video was useful and of your delight. And so please, if you liked this video, please give us a like. If you are interested in more videos of us, please give us your subscription. Make us the gift of your subscription, because to our channel, it helps us to go ahead, to know that there's people who is watching us, to know that there's people who is commenting, to know that people who is liking our videos. It helps us to encourage us to go ahead in a project like this. So may God bless you. A greeting for you to everybody, wherever you are, in whichever part of the world, in Asia, in America, in Central America, and then all Latin America, to the people in my beloved Honduras, in my village there in Honduras, to the people in Africa. I have subscribers from every part of the world, thanks be to God. So I agree to you. May God bless you, and bye bye. See you in another video. And don't forget to subscribe. Bye bye.